will you be our firm foundation. In a life as we go along with so much uncertainty and struggles that we go through, but God, thank you that you are our rock. And God, help us to trust you. But in all the uncertainty, and we don't know what the future holds, the only thing that's certain is you. So God, give us faith to trust. And God, I pray your spirit would move today, Lord, continue to move in this service and to speak through Pastor Adam today. God, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I invite you to be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Crossroads. I'm Adam Steinbach, one of our pastors here, and we're just so thankful that you're joining us today. You know, when I was in seventh grade, I went on this youth retreat with our church, and the purpose of the retreat was to help us grow closer to God. But I got a little distracted on the retreat because that was the first time I met Sarah. And she was a year older. She was super cute. She had this really fun personality. And I kind of felt like maybe she liked me a little bit too. But, you know, I was really new to, like, talking to girls. That was kind of hard for me. So I didn't really know what to do. But after the retreat, I just started kind of, you know, walking past her locker every day after school. And so my best friend Neil and I, on our way home, we would make the trip down the eighth grade hallway. And we'd go and magically run into Sarah and just talk to her after school each day. Well, in life, there is a principle called striking while the iron is hot. I didn't know anything about that. So weeks and weeks and weeks went by of us going, stopping by her locker after school to talk to her before I finally worked up the courage to ask her out. But this was seventh grade. So I tore a corner off of a piece of paper, and I wrote her a little note, and then I passed it to her between class periods, and then I had to wait until the end of the day to talk to her face-to-face. And when I did, that's when she let me know that, you know, she just wanted to be friends. This is the part where you can go, aw, aw, and sympathize with my pain, thank you. And it stung. You know, but that was the end of that. Until a couple weeks later, when my best friend Neil had a new girlfriend. It was Sarah. And so every day after school on our way home, we'd make the trip down the eighth grade hallway to talk to Sarah, except now it was for Neil and not for me. Okay, let me ask you, have you ever noticed sometimes in life our relationships, they just get complicated? Like sometimes it's just complicated, like when your best friend is dating the girl that you liked. But it really doesn't matter what kind of relationship it is, marriage relationships, family, work relationships, all of those things, friendships, right? Sometimes it just gets complicated. And yet, relationships are exactly what we're created for. I mean, we need each other. And that's why today we're kicking off our brand new series, It's Complicated, where we're examining some of these struggles, some of these challenges that we can run into in our relationships. And in this series, we're not just talking about marriage relationships or middle school dating, which I do not recommend. But we're talking about all kinds of relationships, our friendships, our work relationships, all these things, because the principles that we see throughout this series apply to all of our relationships. And so even though when it comes to our relationships so many times it's complicated, God has a way for us that is life-giving in our relationships. He wants us to experience relationships done a different way. And so today, to kick off our series, we're going to look at some particularly messed up relationships in the Bible. Okay, this is firmly in the category of examples of what not to do this morning. So if you're trying to understand your Bible, maybe you're reading through the Old Testament, it's really helpful for you to know that there's large sections of the Bible that are descriptive, not prescriptive. Okay, what do I mean by that? What I mean is when the Bible records events or people or conversations or discussions that happen, it's recording what happened. It's not necessarily recording how we should live. I mean, sometimes it is. Sometimes they're examples for us, but sometimes they're not examples that we want to follow. For example, sometimes critics of the Bible will sometimes say, the Bible promotes polygamy because it records examples of polygamy. But just because the Bible records instances of polygamy, like we're going to see in today's passage, does not mean the Bible is recommending that. Okay, the Bible's very clear that God created marriage to be between one man and one woman. And the Bible's also very clear in showing us the negative consequences of relationships done outside of God's design. But here's why this matters for us. Okay, because we can laugh at how messed up these relationships are. But you know, a lot of the things that they struggled with are the exact same things we struggle with too. Our relationships are just as broken, and we have the same root problem. So that's why I want to invite you this morning to turn to Genesis chapter 16. Now, Genesis is the very first book in the Bible. It tells the story of how God originally created the world, and then how the world went terribly wrong. And it also records God's plan to save this world that's fallen into sin. And a big part of that plan was when God called a man named Abram to follow him. And he promised that he was going to bless Abram and that one of Abram's descendants would save this world. Now, Abram would later be called Abraham, and his wife Sarai would later be called Sarah, but he's a great example of faith to us. The Bible says this about him. God made all these promises, and it says, Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith. Man, that is a great life verse, a great summary of his life. And Abram trusted God's promises by faith. And he wasn't perfect, though. He still made mistakes, as we're going to see today. So Genesis 15, God reaffirms his promises to Abram that he's going to bless him, that he's going to give him descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, that he's going to work through Abram, that his descendants, he's going to give them this land that would become the land of Israel. And it all sounds great. It sounds amazing. Until we get to chapter 16. Take a look. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. That's a problem. At this point, Abram's like 85 years old. Sarai's about 75. So things aren't looking very good right now. But God's promised that he's going to give Abram a son. He's promised that through his son and his descendants, he's going to save the world. But it looks like God's plan is in some pretty big trouble right now. And that's when Sarai steps up to bail God out. It says, but she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go, sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her. Okay, right away we know this is a bad idea. Right? This is not going to end well. We know that. But during their day, this was the normal custom. It's really important for us to understand this is what people did in that day. You see, producing an heir was so important. This was of paramount importance. And if you were blessed, if you became pregnant, that was a sign that God was blessing you. And if you couldn't become pregnant, you were cursed. You must have had some secret sin in your life because clearly God must be punishing you, right? And if you were a wife who didn't produce children, you were a disgrace. You could even be divorced because of it. And so one of the acceptable solutions was to take one of your slaves, one of your servant girls, and give her to your husband as a second wife so that there could be an heir, because having an heir was so important. So in this environment, in this context, there is so much pressure on Sarai. She's got all this weight, all these expectations on her, and she's just doing what the world around her did, except she did it without God. But Abram doesn't do much better. It says, Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, that's 10 years with all these promises from God that hadn't been fulfilled, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar and she conceived. And if you thought your life was complicated, right, just wait. When Hagar knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "You are responsible for the wrong I'm suffering. I put my slave in your arms, and now that she knows she's pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me." Okay, now Abram's got a total mess on his hands. I mean, he thought that having a second wife was going to fix this situation. But now there's all this jealousy. There's all this competition between them. I mean, like, who would have seen this coming? But at least now he has an heir, right? At least now God's promises can be fulfilled, right? Now he could step up. Maybe he can provide some leadership in this situation. Verse 6, Abram, come on, here you go. "Your slave is in your hands," Abram said. "Do with her whatever you think best." What? Total fail. Okay, this is like insert facepalm here. Abram, what are you doing? Come on, buddy. Like, you never should have done this in the first place, but now this is one of your wives. She's your wife. She's carrying your child. Like, step up. What is going on? Well, he turns her over to Sarai, and predictably, then Sarai mistreated Hagar. So she fled from her. So there you have it. Maybe you feel better about your life right now. But the truth is, if we want to understand how our relationships get so complicated, we have to look in the mirror. Because the things that Abram and Sarai and Hagar are struggling with are the same things we struggle with. Here we see four ways that you and I, sabotage our relationships. Take a look. First, let's look at Sarai. Right? She's in a really hard spot. Okay, she can't have kids. There's all of this pressure on her. She's carrying the weight of just this shame and this disgrace as a wife that she hasn't done her part. And to her culture, she is a failure, and it's probably her fault. God must be punishing her. I mean, we can think about just the weight of just these feelings of deep inadequacy and deep insecurity and failure that she must have lived with. I mean, Sarai must have felt worthless, like a total failure. And those are feelings we can all struggle with at times. Or we can all wrestle with trying to find an answer to that brokenness inside of us. And unfortunately, Sarai responds in the first way that we sabotage our relationships. When she feels hurt, when she feels like a worthless failure, she does what we often do. She resorts to blaming. Her first step is go to blaming. When things go wrong, it's our natural response to look for somebody else to blame. First, she starts by blaming God in verse 2. Right? God's the one who hasn't allowed me to have kids. But then when she follows through on her plan and then it turns out to be a mess, then it's Abram's fault. Now, he's not blameless. We'll get to him in a minute. But this was her idea, right? She started this whole thing. But the first spot we often look to is to blame somebody else. It's funny. When I was in college, I had a job doing surveying for road work. So we would get the plans that the city or the state had designed up, and we'd stake out the locations and the elevations for road work projects or sewer work so the companies could come and build them. But occasionally something would go wrong, and maybe something would get built in the wrong place. And when that happened, it was a big deal because usually it was thousands of dollars to fix whatever had gone wrong. And what was really important was figuring out who messed this up, because somebody's got to pay for this. And it was almost comical to arrive at the job site when something had gone wrong, because you would instantly watch all of these different people go, it wasn't me, but I just did this. I mean, they were the ones that did that. Yeah, but look, this was on the plan, but look, clearly it's in the wrong spot. Anybody can see that. Well, I didn't do this. They did that. And just all of this blaming and finger pointing. It was almost hilarious. But you know, it's not funny when it's in our relationships and we're blaming each other, the people closest to us. You know, I sit down in a marriage counseling session, and when we're jumping in to the blame game, I know we've got a lot of work to do. And all of us who have been married, we've been there at one point or another. But let me ask you, where do you fall into blaming other people for the difficult situations in your life? You know, where do you struggle with facing in your life just those things where it's broken, but you're convinced that, no, it's not your fault? Right? Blaming others is always destructive in our relationships. And there's a reason why. Maybe you're here. Maybe you're actually thinking, oh, but that other person, look what they did. Look at this. Look what the Apostle Paul says. He writes this in Romans 2, and he's writing to good religious people. And he's writing about bad, immoral people. Look what he says. You, good religious people, you may think you can condemn such people, those bad people, but you're just as bad. And you have no excuse when you say they are wicked, they should be punished. You're condemning yourself, for you who judge others do the very same things. Actually, I feel like some of us maybe should have this taped on our phone or our computer before and read it before we go posting on social media. He says, wherever we are judging someone else, we are condemning ourselves. At whatever point you blame someone else, you better look in the mirror, because blaming often comes from our own failures. Let me just give you a simple example of this. Maybe you can relate. When I'm running late and I need to be somewhere and I'm in a hurry, you know, I can often get frustrated with other drivers on the road. I mean, they're driving so slow. I mean, they're in the wrong lane. Like, what are you doing? They're like super cautious when they're making those turns. It's like, come on, some of us have some place to be. But whose fault is it? It's my fault, right? I should have left earlier. I should have not tried to cram so many things into my day. Right? I should have planned better. It's my fault. But conveniently, I always find someone else to blame. I'm sure that's never happened to you, right? Okay. But think about this in your relationships. Think about this at work. What about that conflict situation at work, that coworker that you just can't stand, you just don't want to deal with, you have all these issues and problems with, right? It's always their fault. There's always something they're doing. They're the problem. But what if it was you? What if you were part of the issue? Or, you know, when you're going for that promotion and then you don't get it, like, it's always their fault. There's some reason. But we would never think, oh, it's never my fault, right? There's nothing I have to learn. Or how about those disagreements in your family, you know, that always come up when you're hanging out? You don't play any part in that, right? I mean, it's never our fault. Even in the situations where we know we've messed up, we always have reasons why we messed up, like why we ended up doing that. Yeah, okay, screwed up, but it's not exactly my fault because of this, right? And the problem is blaming is incredibly destructive in our relationships. It destroys trust. It divides people. And the solution to blaming, well, it's to take personal responsibility, right? We have to lean into that. It doesn't mean that that other person doesn't have things they need to work on too, right? But we have to start by looking in the mirror and addressing the things that we need to deal with, Right? We need to own the things that are our fault. And if you want to transform your relationships, if you want to transform your marriage, your friendships, right, start by looking in the mirror. What are the ways that God wants to grow you? Where do you fall into blaming? Now, there's a second way that we see here that we sabotage our relationships as well. And Sarai helps us out with this one too. So if you want to make a mess of things, blaming will do the trick, but so will controlling. Try controlling. That'll make a mess of things. Now, God did not come through for Sarai like she wanted him to. So she's got a plan to make everything right. And she has a part for Abram to play. She has a part for Hagar to play. And she has a part for God to play. And her plan sounds really great, and she's got this all under control until it goes horribly wrong. Let me ask you, do you ever feel like you need to help God out? Do you ever feel like you need to move his plan along a little bit? If a classic example of this would be when we just know in our heart, God has not called me to be single. But I just can't find that other person who loves Jesus and is passionate about putting him first in life. So what do we do then? I mean, just wait? Like, God wouldn't call us to that, right? So what do we do? Oh, you know, there's that really cute person at the gym who has everything I ever wanted in a spouse. They just maybe aren't pursuing God right now. But hey, we can fix that, right? Come on, God, bless this plan. Maybe God wants to use me to reach them, we think. Funny how that never works out. We call that missionary dating. And God says, don't do it. It's a really bad idea, but that's our plan. We just want God to bless our plan, to make our plan work out. That's Sarai. She's got a plan, and she wants God to bless it. And for a moment, just a moment, it looks like maybe she is trying to help God out. I mean, God made these promises, and they're not happening. And God never said how he was going to provide these ancestors for Abram. So maybe this is his will, right? Except when she goes forward with this plan and it all goes wrong and there's all this jealousy between Hagar and Sarai, that's when we find out that this was never really about Sarai at all. Right? It was never really about God at all. Excuse me. It was about Sarai. Right? This is about removing her disgrace. This is about covering up her shame, dealing with her issues. And the root issue with Sarai's controlling is it's not about anybody else. It's about her. Think about that for a minute. Think about the situations in your life that you might be tempted to try and control. Who is it really about in those cases? Think about your kids. Maybe you're really active in managing your kid's life. You have a great plan for them. You know what sports they should be in, what team they need to be on. Maybe you know where they should be going to school one day, what kind of career they should pursue. And we tell ourselves, right, it's for their own good. It's because we love them so much. We just want the best for them, right? Right? I mean, do we really? Is it really about them? Or is it about us looking good? Is it about us being able to brag that, well, our kid does this or that? Hey, shut up and smile for the picture so we look good on Facebook, right? Right? How often is it really about us? But what's the answer to controlling? It's serving. Even Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life for others. And that's the answer for us. When we want to control the people in our lives, we have to choose to serve them instead of trying to manage them and manipulate them to get what we want. Okay, but look, Sarai is not the only one who's messed up here. Abram is right there with her. And when Sarai comes to him with this foolish plan, right, instead of standing up and saying, no, we are not doing this. Instead, he goes along with it. And then when it turns out horribly, instead of standing up for his new wife who's carrying his child, he just turns her over to Sarai. I mean, Abram is a guy who at times displays amazing faith. And at times he makes some really boneheaded moves, which I kind of appreciate because I can be an idiot sometimes too. But here he shows us the third way that we sabotage our relationships, and that's with ignoring. Abram's problem is ignoring. He ignores his responsibility to lead his wife, and then when things go wrong, he just washes his hands of the whole situation. But what if he would have stepped up? What if he would have been the man of faith God has called him to be? What if he would have provided some leadership to this situation and said, no, we're going to trust God to provide. We're not going to try and do this in our own power. Right? Then this never would have happened. But he gets led astray. It's interesting when I was studying this passage, there are some commentators, not every, most don't go this direction, but there were some commentators who actually kind of let Abram off the hook. There were some people who felt like, yeah, you know, it's not really his fault. He didn't know how God was going to provide and answer these promises, and nothing in the text says that he actually sinned. But I think that totally misses the point. Look at verse 3. It says, so after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. Sarai took Hagar and gave her to Abram. What does that sound a lot like? Somebody shout it out. What do you think? Any guesses? What does that sound like? That, okay, right? The apple, the Garden of Eden, right? Eve takes the fruit, she gives it to her husband when he should have stood up and led in that situation. Abram is repeating the pattern of the fall in Genesis 3. When he needs to step up, he just goes passive and he tries to ignore these problems. Now, some of you have been there in your relationships. You've tried this. I will have to confess that I've tried this one. This is one I struggle with. But you come home from a long day, right? You're tired, you're exhausted, you're hungry, you just want to rest. And then there's a situation that needs your help, that needs your attention, but instead of stepping up and helping out, you just want to let it go. It's easier to let them figure it out. Or for some of you, you know, you're not in a great spot with your spouse. But you keep telling yourself, you know, when we just get through this season, then things will get better. And you ignore those problems in your marriage and hope it'll go away. Anybody else struggle with that? Okay, I'm the only one. Whoa, this is tough. But what's the problem with ignoring these problems, right? Well, first of all, it's selfish. It's just focused on our own comfort, rather than doing what's right for the people around us. And ignoring problems is unfair because it short circuits any healing that could happen in our relationships. And ignoring problems doesn't work because when we ignore those issues, they just get bigger the more you pretend they're not there. Let me ask you this morning, where are you ignoring problems in your relationships? Where are you hoping that those issues maybe will just kind of go away and fade away? Where do you want to just pretend that it's going to get better? Maybe your kid's in a tough space, but you're not really sure how to help them, so you just kind of hope that they'll get out of it. Maybe you're in one of those places where you've been ghosting your friend because you don't want to deal with that misunderstanding that you guys had. You don't want to face it. Or are you in that spot where maybe you blow up sometimes in frustration with the people around you? And then when you finally calm down, you just pretend that everything's normal? Are you the kind of person that when there's problems, when there's struggles in life, you just kind of want to hide and ignore them? You run to things like video games or social media or TV to just pretend that those problems aren't there, right? Ignoring problems will sabotage your relationships. And it's a lot like the fourth problem that we see here, and that's running. Hagar takes off running. Now, Hagar, she's the least to blame in this situation, right? But she wasn't perfect either. And when she found out that she was pregnant, she really started to feel quite a bit better than Sarai. Sarai couldn't get pregnant, and now she's pregnant. She feels like now she's something. But then, of course, there's all this conflict, and she doesn't know what to do, so she just takes off. She just runs. Well, let me be clear this morning. In relationships, there is a time to run. There is a time to go, to get out of a relationship. Okay, if you're in a dating relationship with somebody who's battling an addiction, okay, please do not think that you're going to be the one to save them. You actually might be distracting them from getting the help that they really need. I mean, don't be so arrogant to think that your love is going to be what's going to pull this person out. No, that doesn't work. Might be time to walk away so that they can get some help. Because if they can't stay clean, if they keep making promises that they don't keep, then it's time to go. Right? You shouldn't be dating that person. Or if you're here and you're being physically abused in a relationship, okay, all the stats would say it is not going to get better, it's going to get worse. And if that's you, you need to get help and you need to get out. You need to go. Or if you've got that group of friends that you like to hang out with, and they're fun, but when you're with them, you just find yourself kind of sliding back into some of those old temptations, sliding back into some of those old ways. Look, those friendships may need to go. They're not helping you. They're not encouraging you in your walk with God. Right? There is a time to go. There is a time to leave a relationship. Okay, but some people are going to hear that and say, see, right? See, I need to get out of my marriage because my spouse is not meeting my needs. They don't appreciate me. And that is the spot where we come to the most difficult part of this passage. Look what happens when Hagar runs away. Verse 7. The angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that's beside the road to Shur. And he said, Hagar, slave of Sarai, where have you come from? And where are you going? I'm running away from my mistress Sarai, she answered. Then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. Go back? Submit to her? She was being mistreated. Like, this is not what we're expecting. Why would God send her back to this painful relationship? Look, if you're in a marriage and there's not ongoing, unrepentant adultery, if you're in a marriage and you're not in physical danger, but things are hard. Like, it's really painful at times, and it's difficult. Then it's not time to run from that relationship. It's time to get help. It's time to reach out for help, because if your default response every time there's problems and difficulties in a relationship is to run, you're never going to have deep relationships. You're going to have a repeated pattern of brokenness and hurt and wounds in your life. And if you never engage in those places where there's deep problems, if you never let God work in those areas and in those relationships, you're missing the opportunity of what God wants to do in you, how he wants to grow you, how he wants to transform you. God's likely calling you to face into those areas of struggle, to face into those problems. That's how you're going to grow. He wants you to work through them instead of running from them. But how is Hagar supposed to do that? Look what God does for her, verse 10. The angel added, I will increase your descendants so much that they will be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord also said to her, you are now pregnant, and you will give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard of your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand will be against him. And he will live in hostility toward all his brothers. Okay, this is one of the strangest promises in the Bible. Let's just say it. But let's not get lost in whatever in the world verse 12 means and miss the big picture. I mean, don't miss what's happening here. First of all, God appears to Hagar. That's incredible. Okay, she is the first woman in the Bible to receive a birth promise announcement from God himself. And she's not even Jewish. She's an Egyptian slave. And not only does God deal with her personally, but he also makes all these promises to her, just like he promised to Abram. She's going to have a son. And her son's name, Ishmael, means God hears. God hears. God knows the suffering that she's enduring, and he promises her, her son has a future. He's not going to be the son that God's going to use to bring the Messiah into the world, but her son has a future. Okay, so he's going to be a wild donkey of a man. Not exactly a compliment, okay? What it does mean, it probably refers to a Bedouin lifestyle. He's going to live out in the desert. He's going to be nomadic. He's going to be independent. He's going to be stubborn. There's going to be conflict between him, hostility between him and his brothers. But it also means something else. And don't miss this, because this is what Hagar realized. This means he's going to be free. Hagar was a slave, but her son is going to be free. And when Hagar gets this promise, verse 13, she gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her, "You are the God who sees me." For she said, "I have now seen the one who sees me." She can go back and she can endure the suffering that she's facing because God sees her. God knows what she's going through, and God has promised her family a future. And here we see all of these ways that we sabotage our relationships by blaming and by controlling and ignoring and running. But here we also see God's solution for our broken relationships, and it's grace. God's solution is grace. Look at the grace that just permeates this whole passage, his grace towards everyone in this chapter. I mean, God is so gracious towards Sarai, right? She's really hurt. She's in a tough spot, but she's hurting other people too. But God doesn't give up on her. Eventually, Sarai would bear Abram a son, and it would be a miraculous promise, a miraculous deliverance by God's power. And it'll be clear, she doesn't deserve it. It's just grace. And look at God's grace to Abram here, right? He's blessed by God. He's a man with big faith and an embarrassing pattern of failures. And he doesn't deserve for God to choose him and work through him. It's just grace. Or look at God's blessing on Hagar here. God sees Hagar's suffering. He's with her in this difficult time, and he promises to give her and her family a future. He doesn't take her pain away, but he's with her, and she doesn't deserve it. It's just grace. I'm telling you this morning, the ultimate power that will transform our relationships is grace. When we learn to receive that grace from God that we so desperately need,